Rock News Weekly Podcast, week of August 19th, 2024, Season 6, Episode number 31. This week, we talk about Green Day announcing their huge box set to celebrate the 25th anniversary of American Idiot coming out in October. And both surviving Beatles make classic concerts available for the digital age, as George Harrison's concert for Bangladesh and Paul McCartney's rare one-hand clapping films both get updates and wide releases in 2024. Plus, this week in rock and roll history trivia, weekly WTF, and so much more. Everything's up at rocknewsweekly.com. Watch us live every Sunday, twitch.tv/rocknewsweekly, and on demand, youtube.com/rocknewsweekly.
Hey, what's up, everybody? It's time for the Rock News Weekly podcast. Chris here, as well as Dahlia. How's it going?
Hey.
And we have a new addition to the family, as well as the podcast and everything. This is Penny.
Hi, Penny.
Say hello to Penny, the puppy. Penny,
the crazy terror,
is pretty wild. She is a chocolate lab, and she came into our life unexpectedly, and she's here now, and she's ready
and
to go.
We're dealing with it.
Yeah, and she is in full-on puppy mode. She's only 8 weeks old, so she's chewing up everything. Wouldn't be surprised if she starts chewing up the mic, and there she goes. Dolly is going to be playing a puppy wrangler during the episode today.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, she likes chewing on this carpet that's down below here, which she is already doing. So you have fun with that, babe, while I get to the rock news.
Yeah.
All right, so what do we got to talk about this week? Oh, yes, don't get the audio cable there. Okay, we got lots to talk about, including Green Day, their 25th anniversary of American Idiot coming out in October. So they got this big box set. We'll go over what's included in that. Both surviving Beatles, classic concerts available for the digital age, as you just heard. George Harrison's concert for Bangladesh, legendary one from him, as well as a rare one from Paul McCartney with one hand clapping. We'll talk about all that stuff. Check us out, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, all at Rock News Weekly, and of course, rocknewsweekly.com, Spotify, 8 different platforms, however you're listening, we're out there. Okay, Mammoth American Idiot 20th Anniversary Box Set. Hard to believe this album just came out 20 years ago in 2004. It seems not too long ago, but I guess time just flying by as they're celebrating another landmark for the band. This is a big box set for the guys. Looks like it includes 15 unreleased demo recordings, a live performance of the band's 2004 concert at Irving Plaza in New York City, including 9 previously unreleased live recordings. That's pretty cool. A variety of B-sides and bonus tracks. Both packages also contain 2 Blu-ray discs featuring a new 110-minute documentary. It's called Heart Like a Hand Grenade and it includes various live performances. Specific to the vinyl set will be a 36-page book, a large Green Day flag, Billy Joe Armstrong's iconic American Idiot red tie. Additionally, each LP comes pressed on its own unique vinyl variant color. It's all coming out October 25th, a limited edition color vinyl as well, audiophile one-step release of the album. I'm not sure what that's all about, but I believe it's a high-quality, some type of a recording there. So pretty cool for Green Day fans. Make sure you guys check that one out. Looks to be the definitive edition of that album, celebrating 20th anniversary this year. Pretty wild.
And the task at hand, if you're wondering, if you're watching why we look like a hot mess, we just got back from a 4-day, 3-night excursion in San Francisco.
Yeah, birthday weekend. And we'll talk about it because we have a Deftones story coming
up.
Oh,
good.
And we'll do a quick recap after the Deftones story of our concert experience at System of a Down this past Saturday.
Yeah, we were stuck on a train for a while, so we were kind of a little bit of a hot mess. You know, we just got home. We haven't really got cleaned up or anything like that yet. So, if you're watching,
well, thanks
that's
for throwing
why.
That out there. Dahlia can't stand it. She's like, I look horrible. I got to let everyone know.
I hope, man, our train was delayed. Yeah. We were outside Antioch.
Let's not talk about
that. Okay.
Paul McCartney and Wings, rare one-hand release, or excuse me, one-hand clapping film getting its theatrical release. This is going to be cool. It's going to be in cinemas worldwide beginning September 26th. It's part of the Paul McCartney and Wings tour and their rehearsals that they did at Abbey Road Studios for Band on the Run. Finally getting a wide theatrical release. They're going to do some screenings, as I mentioned, September 26th. And the updated version of the film is going to feature a new introduction by McCartney himself, as well as the famous Backyard Session, where the former Beatle covers Buddy Holly songs on an acoustic guitar. He says, quote, "It's so great to look back on that period and see the new and see the live little live show we did," McCartney said in a statement. "We made a pretty good noise, actually. It was a great time for the band. We started to have success with Wings, which had been a long time coming. The release of the film version One Hand Clapping complements the release of the movie soundtrack that came out earlier this year." So you interested in that, checking that one out at all?
I actually am. You know, I'm a McCartney fan.
Definitely. And that's, the Wings era is kind of a cool little era that doesn't get a whole lot of attention. So it's cool that they're going back on that and having some unreleased stuff shown to everybody for the first time. And I like how they're doing it in the theater. So that should be pretty fun. So check that out, September 26th. Speaking of Beatles and new movies for the digital age, he's bringing back the Concert for Bangladesh. It's now available on streaming platforms for the first time ever. On Apple, whatever you guys like to stream, it's out there. Concert for Bangladesh. Back in 1971, it was the large-scale music benefit show. There was a lot of them going on at that time. And it took place over two shows in New York's Madison Square Garden. Ringo Starr, Bob Dylan, Ravi Shankar, Eric Clapton, they were all a part of it. Focused on raising money for UNICEF, awareness of humanitarian crisis of the Bangladesh Libertarian War, which had not been covered in depth by the Western media, so they were trying to bring attention to that. And it's all for a good cause and some pretty cool rare footage, so definitely check that out. Also, they have the LP set reissued for the first time. It's a 3-LP box set. You guys can grab it on the official website there. More than 50 years after the concert, so pretty awesome that they're doing all this stuff and getting it ready for a new generation. So there you go, Concert for Bangladesh, now available however you guys stream your stuff. Oh, and just a side note, that 4-part film series about the Beatles is in the works from director Sam Mendes. We talked about that, I think, a month or two ago, working on securing complete approval for music rights to create a biopic focused on each member of the band for the Beatles. So it's going to be pretty cool next couple years for Beatles and Beatles fans. All right, let's go on to the next one here. This is a big landmark for Metallica this week. Sales of Metallica's Ride the Lightning soared around the album's 40th anniversary, also celebrating 40th anniversary this year. Came out July 27th, 1984.
Wow.
The original release date, July 27th, 1984, celebrating 40th anniversary just last week. And they had a bunch of, album sales to kind of commemorate that, and they actually re-entered the U.S. Billboard Top 100 charts, and it's pretty awesome. So it sits at number 24 in the American sales rank, which is a huge improvement over the 100 slot the album released when it was first back in 1984. So kind of crazy when no one knew who Metallica was in 1984, didn't barely even crack the Top 100, and now with the 40-year anniversary coming in at number 24, pretty cool. And a great album, right? I think that album and Master of Puppets, I think, are my favorite Metallica albums. And I'd say even Ride the Lightning has a little bit of an edge on it.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
I think that's fantastic. That is a fantastic album. Really good stuff. Anyway, definitely pick that one up if you guys haven't heard it in a while. Aerosmith's final concert. Who knew that it was going to be their final concert? Well, this guy luckily shot the show in 4K. And it's up on YouTube now. It's the band's September 2023 gig at UBS Arena in Elmont, New York. Now it stands as the band's official last show. So now it's on YouTube in 4K, and you guys can check it out. And unfortunately, not going to get any more Aerosmith tours, but doesn't mean we're not going to get any more live performances, right? They could definitely do the Sphere or something, right?
Oh, that'd be cool. Yeah, it's definitely one of the bands I want to see live.
That would be a cool one to see at the Sphere, because
yeah.
I think their catalog, they could do some really cool visual stuff,
mm-hmm.
and put on a good show at the Sphere. And maybe, it wouldn't be hard for Steven Tyler to be in Vegas and do like a little bit of a, break in between shows and that
mm-hmm.
kind of a thing, right? Definitely see that happening. Good for Aerosmith, kind of calling it quits with a little bit of pride and not trying to put on bad shows for the fans. So hopefully they can figure out the recovery from the vocal surgery, and who knows, you know, maybe they'll be able to come back at it with some shows. All right, Deftones. They partner with Belching Beaver Brewery for another one. It's the Bored Blueberry beer that they have here that I have a picture of. It's blueberry wheat. It looks pretty good. I got to say, the blueberry, I do like that kind of flavor with a beer. And it's named after the lead track from their 1995 album, Adrenaline. The specialty brew will be available at all Belching Beaver tap rooms starting on Friday, August 9th. So that was just a little bit ago. And it could be ordered online via Craft Shack. So there you go. So Deftones, let's talk about a recap of the event. San Francisco, System of a Down. Okay, so we saw System of a Down with Deftones, the Mars Volta, Vows, and...
the Viagra Boys.
Viagra Boys. And it was a good show.
It was a great show.
We caught the end of Vows, didn't really see a whole lot of them, so I can't really say how they were, but we did catch the Viagra Boys, and I was, you know, kind of pleasantly surprised.
They're funny.
They were funny.
Like, hey, everybody, we're the Deftones.
And when they were obviously not.
And the people who didn't know who the Deftones were, they're like, yeah. I'm like, oh, he's played a joke on you, you fool.
Yeah, and he's like, yeah, we're a bunch of junkies and 415 for life and all this stuff. So I think they're Bay Area natives and stuff. They were really funny. They were good. And it was good, pretty good music, too. Not bad. But anyway, so the event as a whole, really well run, I will say. It was pretty organized. Done by APE. It was a standalone single concert after Golden Gate Park just finished up with Outside Land. So they left the main stage up, and we were able to check out the show. So what were your impressions, just like the venue itself? Let's start there, and then we'll go to the actual music. Like the venue, the process of getting in, that whole deal. How was that?
Well, if you've never been to Golden Gate Park, rideshare, you definitely need to plan your entrance and exit strategy for how you're getting there and how you're leaving.
One of my friends didn't even get in because he tried to come later and park, and he said he drove around for almost 2 hours.
Oh my God.
Trying to park. This was the other Chris.
Oh no.
And ended up leaving just because they couldn't even find a space. And that's what happens. You know, you come around like the prime time of the show. You're trying to find parking in the area. That's the only thing with Golden Gate Park, and the show's there.
There's no parking.
There's no parking, and they don't support it. They encourage everybody to do rideshare. They offered shuttles where you could park at Cow Palace. And and then there was a Sacramento option as well.
Oh, there was.
But other than that, it was like kind of like you're on your own. Either you're a local or you know how to use the bus. And that was the thing. A lot of people don't really, not very familiar. We've learned over the years to which bus number to take, like the 5. And we figured out kind of had a game plan ahead of time. So for us, it was fairly, you know, we knew what was going on.
Yeah.
But you could tell there was a lot of chaos with kind of the situation, especially the shuttle was getting dropped off in the VIP area, which was 36
and Fulton.
Yeah, and the entrance for Will Call was 25th
and Fulton. 25th
and Fulton. And it's 11 city blocks, and they're big blocks.
11 San Francisco.
Yeah, they're big blocks. And what a lot of people didn't realize is when they got dropped off in the VIP area, they couldn't go to the other side of the park, and they were trying to get to the other side, and they actually got dropped off on one side of the park. And they would have had to have walked around the entire way. And I wonder if that was, like, by design or why they did that, because it's kind of a shitty move. It forced everybody to go inside the venue, and you had to just go in on that side of the park. So that was kind of a weird thing. I didn't really like that. But I thought the VIP offerings were horrible. Just from we didn't take part in them, but just what I could tell, it looked like...
We created our own VIP space on the side of a hill.
Yeah, we had a spot that was...
stage left.
Elevated view, stage left, and it was by the food vendors or the beer garden area. And we put our blanket down, and it was better than the VIP area. I could see where they were at, and they were way far away.
And that big old tent was in front of that part of the stage.
And it was... the weather was nice. It was misty. It was almost like raining, kind of a fog, the way that San Francisco does. But then it kind of cleared up a little bit. Always bring layers if you're going to see a show in San Francisco.
Oh, yeah. It was like the mist, the fog. They call it Carl with a K.
Yeah, it's hilarious.
Our hair was damp.
The like, merch line. Let's talk about that.
Our friend had straight hair when she got there, and
yeah,
she had curly hair when she left.
It was wet. Merch line was insane. I've heard people saying that this was one of the worst merch lines they've seen.
By far.
Because of how just they only had one merch when you come in, then they had a couple on the other side. And they, like, a lot of people were saying they had so many vendors and beer areas and stuff like that, but the merch was so slim in terms of offerings that the people were waiting in line for hours, up to 3-4 hours waiting in line, come to find out that they're out of their size or whatever. And it reminded me a lot of Sick New World, the way that they handled it.
Yeah.
Which was horrible. And so they got to get better with that. I don't know what they can do to make that better, but they need to have more areas for merch with smaller amounts in each area or something, but they need to have more lines instead of just one or two lines where it's you're standing there for almost the entire show. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, it's like somebody said earlier on our trek back, it wasn't a line, it was like a herd of people just crowded in the front. There was no organization to it whatsoever.
So other than that, the show was good. System of a Down was incredible.
Oh my god.
The music was great. Deftones were great. The only thing was the volume I noticed was kind of low because it's an outdoor venue and I'm sure there's like sound decibel restrictions in place.
Yeah.
Where it felt like System of a Down could definitely have been louder. But, you know, hey, it is what it is. It's an outdoor thing. It kind of gets lost in the, you know, outdoor space, but it was still awesome to be able to see all of that. So shout out to them and Another Planet Entertainment for putting on a great event, and hopefully we'll see another one in the future.
Oh, yeah. Your cousin was saying, because she lives in the Bay, they expected 50,000 people, and of the 50,000 people, 40,000 of those were coming from outside of the Bay.
Yeah. So we
out of the country, out of the state, everywhere.
We heard people on our train talking about people that they had met from Australia that had flown out from Australia just for the show.
Mm-hmm.
There was people that were going down to L.A. that were taking the Amtrak that we were, that had gone from L.A. all the way up to San Francisco to see the show, which is a long, that's like a 6-7 hour trek each way.
Mm-hmm. And our train was delayed, and we had a 2-hour. We ended up with a 4-hour.
Yep.
So all
it's the way it goes with traveling that way.
It is, but it's the best way
to
travel.
It was awesome. So we had a great
time. It's better than being stuck in traffic where you can't go to the bathroom, you can't order a beverage, you can't order
some
food.
Very true. Yeah, we had a great time. So it was a great show, and shout out to everybody that went.
I had the best time.
All right, let's get to the birthdays. Let's finish up this episode for the week. All right, let's do it. Birthday time. Dahlia, why don't you take it away? Who do we got this week?
All right. First, we have a birthday on August 12th, Pat Metheny.
Metheny.
All right.
And this goes from August 12th through the 18th. So these are all some prominent rock and roll birthdays throughout the week, or just kind of alternative and guitarists and stuff. Who else?
All right. Mark Knopfler, Dire Straits. Born in 1949.
Yep.
Happy
birthday. He's still touring, too.
All right. Kevin Cadogan from Third Eye Blind.
Yeah, the guitarist.
Yeah, I get it, guy.
So there you go. Born on 14th.
August 14th birthdays. I didn't see any August 13th birthdays.
No, there wasn't any that I could find.
Except for yours truly.
Yep. That's definitely that's a good one.
All right, Slim Dunlap from The Replacements had a birthday this week, August 14th. Happy birthday. Madonna, fellow Leo, August 16th, born in 1958.
Yeah.
Still looking fabulous.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And I want to know who her plastic surgeon is for like 10 years from now.
Yeah, because that'll cost you $10 million.
$10 million, you think?
Who knows? I don't know.
Who knows? All right, born on August 16th. Tim Ferriss from NXS. Happy birthday, bro. August 17th, Steve Gorman from the Black Crowes, 1965, he was born. August 18th, the looks like guitarist bassist from Everlast.
It's a guitarist. He's just a solo artist. He was the guy that, you remember that group, they were a kind of a hip-hop kind of thing. House of Pain in the 90s. Mm. Well, Everlast was the guitarist, that guy, and he broke off and did his own thing. And so, yeah.
I love the tuning knobs on what from what I can see on the top of the guitar. They look like colorful.
I believe it was House of Pain. Mm. I'm probably wrong on that. Who knows? I don't know anyway.
All right, Dennis Elliott. Happy birthday. August 18th. He's from Foreigner. Born in 1950. Drummer.
Yeah.
Doing
still
great.
Drumming. Still kicking ass. So
get it.
Yeah, man. I think they're on their one of their final tours or something right now, if I'm not mistaken. So get out and see them while you can.
Mm-hmm.
All right, we got some trivia. You ready for trivia?
This week
in rock and roll history.
Trivia?
All right, we got some trivia. Dahlia, this week, 18th of August, 1984, after toiling in clubs, this band released their debut album, all right? Who was it?
I feel like I know this.
Was it REM? Was it Red Hot Chili Peppers? Was it Pantera? Or was it New Wave Crosby and the coked out synthesizers of Sussex? 1984, it was big back then.
Okay, I lied. I don't know it, but I'm going to give it a wild guess. Okay, so August 18th, 1984, after years of toiling in clubs, this band released their debut album. I'm going to go with Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Red Hot Chili Peppers, all right. We'll see if she's right. Drum roll. Red Hot Chili Peppers is correct.
Boom!
Here's a picture of them, one of their first promotional photos.
Oh, wow.
Of them.
Why do they have cups all? Is that cups?
Yeah, they have like these things attached to the little things on their jackets. So it looks like the cups are just like hanging there. I don't know. It's weird. And then here's their album.
Wow.
From 1984, their debut, Red Hot Chili Peppers.
That's
so.
A cool album cover.
Yeah.
Take yeah. note, all of you who are seeking to put out a new album.
Yeah, there you go. All right, new rock and metal albums out this week. Friday, August 16th, these all came out. Dahlia, take it away. What do we got?
Okay, we have Avernus with Grievances.
Yeah. And it looks like a cool little vinyl set. Black ash-colored vinyl, it says. So there you go. Pre-orders at m-theoryaudio.com. There you go.
All right. Creed, Human Clay 25th Anniversary Edition.
We know Dahlia got this pre-ordered. She was...
How dare you, Moreno.
She was adamant that, when this was announced, I have to get my copy.
Maybe I do want to listen to it. How about that?
Yeah. I bet.
Human Clay, didn't they have... Should've been dead
me, yeah.
on a Sunday morning, banging my head.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
All right. Dark Tranquility and Time Signals off of Century Media Records. I like that little salmon-colored vibe they have
yeah.
on the vinyl.
It's cool.
Extinction 80 to the Detested off of Unique Leader Records. Do you think these are independent labels, or are they actually going somewhere and paying for these?
Oh, they're paying. Well, I mean, they pay for anything unless it says it's self-released.
Mm.
And even then, they're footing the bill themselves. Unique Leader is a kind of a boutique label, smaller label. So these labels sometimes front the bill for the band, but a lot of times they split the cost, especially with vinyl releases. The band will put up a certain amount. The label will put up a certain amount. They meet in the middle, and then they kind of, they work out a deal.
Mm-hmm.
So.
All right. Falling in Reverse, Popular Monster off of Epitaph. Gel Persona off of Blue Grape.
Yeah, that's kind of a cool one.
That's a cool one.
I've been liking these guys. They're pretty heavy, and they're pretty cool. I've been playing a track or two off of this album on the Bear, and it's pretty awesome, so definitely check it out if you guys are looking for something new, kind of heavy. What else?
I'm sorry. Stone Jesus, the Harvest re-release off of the label is Season of Mist.
There you go.
All right. Thought Crime, Connection Anxiety, record label Prosthetic.
Yep.
Looks like a band we might interview at Aftershock. I don't think they're there this year.
Yeah.
But looks like the type
of band.
They
look interesting. They look pretty cool.
Yep. Trench, Between Inverted Worlds.
Yeah, that one's like a sci-fi kind of thing going on there. Cool. All right, I think that's it for the new albums. Did you hear about this other planet that they found, this K2-18b, potentially habitable planet? It's covered with oceans and about 2.6 times the size of Earth. There's a picture of it.
I did, because I follow this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I'm kind of weird in that way. I'm full on into, like, astronomy and NASA. I'm like, I miss my calling at working for NASA, because that's kind of my vibe.
Well, they say they've just detected carbon dioxide and methane in its atmosphere, can only be produced by living beings. So they're wondering what exactly is going on there. It's 124 light years away from Earth. The planet is a sub-Neptune, about 2.6 times the radius of Earth, 33-day orbit within the star's habitable zone. Means it receives a similar amount of starlight as the Earth from the sun. It was initially discovered with the Kepler Space Telescope, and later observed by the James Webb Space Telescope in order to study the planet's atmosphere. So they detected, like I was mentioning, just last year, carbon dioxide and methane in the atmosphere of this planet, and the data has been variously interpreted as indicating a water ocean or magma ocean planet with a hydrogen-rich atmosphere. So they're saying it's actually more closely resembling a gas planet like Uranus or Neptune than Earth, but still, a pretty cool discovery and interesting.
Yeah, well, if there's a high level of methane, that's kind of a cause for concern that it may not be habitable, because we're trying to...
Depends on what the levels of it are.
We're trying to lower our methane emissions here on planet Earth.
Sure.
So...
But we do produce it, and that's the point, is that only those things can supposedly be produced by living beings. So it's interesting. Yeah, I like that stuff, too. It just makes you think, you know, like how small things are out there in the universe, right?
Mm-hmm.
Puts a lot of stuff into perspective. All right, that's it for us this week, guys. Make sure you tune in every week. RockNewsWeekly.com. Watch us on demand. YouTube.com. If you can't catch us live on Twitch, we try and go live every Sunday. Twitch.tv/RockNewsWeekly. Give us a like, give us a follow so you get updated when we do go live if you guys want to chat with us or whatever. All socials @RockNewsWeekly, and we will see you guys next week. Have a good one, all right? Peace. Bye-bye.